Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. Any member wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. I can advise the Chamber there's a lot of interest in both portfolios, so I would appreciate brief questions and brief responses. And I call question number one, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it will report on its consultation on proposals to close fishing for sand eel in all Scottish waters.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The consultation on proposals to close fishing for sand eel in all Scottish waters closed on the 13th of October, and my officials are carefully considering all the responses that we received. Following this analysis, we'll publish the consultation outcome report, which is currently scheduled to be published by spring 2024.
Bruce Maguire.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Scotland's important globally for its large seabird colonies, supporting over 65% of the British and Irish seabird population. Our seabirds, including the Manx shearwater, are under multiple man-made pressures through predation, adverse weather conditions, which may be a result of climate change, and a lack of food as a result of both climate change and fisheries. The RSPB described proposals to ban industrial sand eel fishing as the single greatest thing we can do right now to help our most threatened seabird species. Does the Minister agree with me that Scotland's wonderful seabirds, including the Manx shearwater, are a hugely important part of Scotland's coastal ecology, and actions to protect populations in the face of current and future threats are vital?
Minister.
Yes, I absolutely do. And that quote from Ruth Maguire about what the RSPB said about this being the single biggest thing we can do to protect our seabirds is warmly welcomed, and I agree with them. The results of the recent seabird census shows that Scotland's internationally important seabird population are really suffering as a result of ongoing pressures. Ruth Maguire mentioned man-made pressures, which have resulted in climate change. And given the importance of the sand eel to the wider ecosystem and the subsequent benefit in aiding that long-term sustainability and resilience, it's a priority to make sure that the population of sand eels is sustained. It's not just the Manx shearwater that benefits from there's iconic species like puffins in particular that feed on sand eels, so this is something that we are prioritising to help boost the seabird population.
Thank you. Supplementary, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for being clear on that. Can I just remind the Minister and the Chamber of my register of interest that I'm a partner in a wild salmon fishery, and salmon do eat sand eels, but I want to talk today about the damage that our seabirds have faced regarding avian flu, which has been catastrophic, and there will undoubtedly be some losses when ScotWind is up and running. So therefore, surely we must make sure our seabirds are in the best possible condition, and there are as many as possible to offset these losses. Therefore, sand eel fisheries should be suspended immediately. Does the Minister agree?
Minister.
I thank Edward Mountain for that very positive and constructive question and for his support in what we're doing about the sand eel fisheries. He rightly points out that there's quite a lot of other factors involved in the decline of seabirds. And of course, this summer in particular, we had a very unseasonable bout of really quite pernicious avian flu, which particularly affected our gannet population as well as gull population as well. So we must do everything we can in our powers to sort of mitigate the effects of things that, you know, like avian flu, that we can't really control the source of that, but we can control how we respond to that.
Thank you. Question two, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact the recently announced trilateral agreement on total allowable catch limits and management measures for jointly managed fish stocks in the North Sea will have on fishers in Aberdeen and the northeast of Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Mary Goujon.
Fishing agreements with our coastal state partners include a number of positive outcomes for Scotland, providing key opportunities to vessels and to coastal communities too. The trilateral agreement includes quota increases for all six of the jointly managed North Sea stocks, and these opportunities are worth an estimated £199 million to Scotland, and that's an increase of £68 million compared to the previous year. Now, this is welcome news for Scotland's fishing industry as a whole, and the benefit to fishers in the North East from that trilateral is currently estimated to be around £47 million based on 2022 prices.
Jackie Dunbar.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. I understand that there has been an agreement to set quotas for North Sea cod at levels reflective of the latest science. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what scientific data and analysts goes into these determinations, and what was Scotland's overall approach to the negotiations?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would want to state, first of all, that, of course, the Scottish Government fully supports the headline scientific advice and, of course, setting fishing opportunities that are consistent with maximum sustainable yield approach and, of course, doing that whenever that's most appropriate. Now, while we use the MSY approach from ICES and a benchmark report from February, there was quite a significant change in the 2024 scientific advice for North Sea and West of Scotland cod. And that new advice structure shows that the stocks in Scottish waters are doing well, and particularly that northwestern substock, which spawns in the northwest North Sea and the west of Scotland. So that ultimately reflects what we know our fishers have been seeing on the ground, and it is a step change away from the previous zero tack advice for the west of Scotland. However, the actual scientific advice for the whole northern shelf was based on the poor state of the southern stock component, which of course we think is illogical in its approach. So my priority ask for the annual negotiations was to secure catch limits which reflect that positive outlook for the northwestern stock, including an appropriate and evidence-based allocation to the west of Scotland. And I'm really pleased that that negotiated outcome was 15% increase supported by that robust evidence.
Thank you. I'm going to need a briefer response to this. I'm going to get both supplementaries in. First, Jamie Hawker-Jones.
The Cabinet Secretary will recognise that this deal was made possible due to the UK being out of the hated common fisheries policy, allowing us to set our own total allowable catches, licence foreign fishing vessels in UK waters and regulate fisheries in Scotland. So will the Cabinet Secretary accept that Scotland's future is outside of the CFP, with decisions in consultation with our fishermen and our fishing communities made here in Scotland and the UK and not in Brussels, as the SNP would have?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member has ultimately failed to read the trade and cooperation agreement that his colleagues in the UK government signed up to, and that actually saw a poorer deal for our fishermen than when we were in the CFP. So I would strongly urge him to take a read of that and maybe come back and offer comments at that point.
I'm Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. The North Sea and the Trilateral Agreement are important to Shetland's fishing fleet, and the Cabinet Secretary recently committed to exploring solutions for several important fish stocks which are classed as data deficient by scientists. How will the Scottish Government work with international partners to ensure adequate resource to ascertain the scientific advice that is so critical to sustainable fisheries management, and what timeline can we expect for that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Just to say that I'm happy to engage further with the member in relation to that as well, but I would say that the work that we undertake and the relationships that we have with our international partners are really critical. Our chief negotiator and our negotiating teams have done a really fantastic job in terms of the negotiations this year, but they work incredibly hard on fostering those key relationships so that we can work together on these issues where there are problems presented. But I'm more than happy to follow up with the member via correspondence and provide further information in relation to that.
Question three, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what proportion of the costs of the licensing schemes contained within the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Scotland Bill will be covered by the licence fees.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Nature Scot does not currently operate any licences on a cost recoverable basis, and this bill does not mandate charges for the three new licence schemes set out in the provisions. However, the Scottish Government has committed to review the wider species licensing system and assess the potential to apply the principle of full cost recovery to species licensing. The bill, therefore, allows for the possible introduction of charges for licences issued in the future by providing that licence authority may charge a reasonable fee.
John Mason.
I do thank the Minister for that answer, but I just wonder if there is any reason why she thinks that the full cost shouldn't be recovered through fees, because that would mean otherwise there's a subsidy from the public sector.
Minister.
I have to say I agree with the sentiment of John Mason's challenge there. I mean, what we want to do is ensure that charges, any changes to policy are fair and proportionate. That's why our commitment to review that species licences include the consideration of potential to apply the principle of full cost recovery. It's, it, the,
Every licence will have complexities associated on an individual basis, so we want to make sure it is proportionate. But Mr Mason can be assured that I am actively looking at the idea of full cost recovery for all licences.
And supplementary, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Grouse shooting sustains 2,640 full-time equivalent jobs in Scotland in fragile and rural communities and contributes £30 million to the Scottish economy. Isn't it the case, Minister, that the Scottish Government have no idea of the socio-economic impact of the proposed licence scheme for grouse shooting in Muirburn on land managers, which may cause job losses and disinvestment to the sector? When will the Minister publish an impact assessment on the effect on a regional basis of the Government's legislation?
Minister.
So it's very clear, it's been clear in all the exchanges that Rachel Hamilton has made on this, that she is fundamentally against licensing shooting estates. Licensing shooting estates will bring them in line with quite a lot of other practices which need licences to operate. I think actually that's going to be a very good thing for the sector. It's going to show public confidence in the sector that people are licensed to operate within the law. It's also in keeping with many other shooting estates across the whole of Europe. So I would say to
Ms Hamilton,
I am not prepared
the question,
to be
allow the
that.
Answer to be Minister, continue.
I'm going to leave it there, Presiding Officer. I think that's
Thank you. Question number four, Douglas Lumsden.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on when the previously ring-fenced £33 million of funding allocated to the agricultural sector as a result of the Bew review will be returned to its budget for the portfolio covering agriculture.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary.
The Deputy First Minister made clear in her budget statement yesterday that we are committed to returning all of this funding to my portfolio to invest in agricultural priorities at the appropriate time. £15 million will be returned over this coming financial year and will be entirely spent on agricultural priorities. We will also provide the same level of support through direct payments to farmers and crofters that was available before Brexit, and we're currently providing farmers and crofters with the most generous package of direct support anywhere in the UK, and I'm sure that that's something the member would want to welcome and support. It is, of course, right that uncommitted spend is deferred to mitigate the ongoing cost of living crisis, and all portfolios have been asked to make similar and very difficult choices. But I can assure the member that agriculture spending is ring-fenced for this portfolio, and it will return to ensure it delivers for the needs of the rural economy.
Douglas Lumsden.
Cabinet Secretary, the NFUS are rightly furious that this SNP Green devolved government has failed to return £61 million of withdrawn agriculture funds in the draft budget. And today we are only hearing about 25% of that funding returning, while at the same time cutting other agricultural funds. So can the Cabinet Secretary explain to Scotland's farmers and crofters why the SNP are not standing up for rural Scotland, and when will our farmers get all their money back?
Cabinet Secretary.
This government is the government in these islands that is standing up for our rural communities and for our farmers and crofters. And if I can actually answer the question that Douglas Lumsden has posed, because to say, first of all, in relation to the comments from NFUS, I absolutely understand their concerns. And that's why I would want to reiterate that the £61 million that has been deferred spending is ring-fenced. It must be returned to the portfolio. And as the Deputy First Minister has confirmed to the NFUS, as well as to this chamber yesterday, every penny of it will be returned to this portfolio to be spent on agricultural priorities. But I would point out exactly what was put forward in the budget yesterday and the levels of protection that we have offered in relation to other schemes that aren't available elsewhere in the UK. And again, I would ask that the member, if he welcomes that, when we look at our basic payment scheme, Greening, LFAS, all schemes that are absolutely critical for our farmers and crofters, which are still being maintained as part of this budget. There are difficult choices that every single portfolio has had to be made, and really difficult decisions, as the Deputy First Minister outlined yesterday. But I reiterate that commitment. The money is due back to the portfolio, and it will be returned to the portfolio.
I'm going to take a supplementary, but I'm going to remind those on the Conservative benches they can ask a question. They can't then provide a running commentary throughout the answer. I'm going to take Rhoda Grant for a supplementary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Agriculture funding is paid to devolve governments under historic EU settlements rather than through the Barnett formula. This formula sees Scotland receive around 17% of agriculture funding due to the greater proportion of farming and crofting land. Does the Cabinet Secretary recognise that cutting the agriculture budget could put this payment framework in jeopardy and certainly does not help those of us making the case for a greater share of that funding?
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, I would reiterate the points that I made in my previous response there, that this is deferred spending that will be returned to the portfolio and which has to be returned to the portfolio, as the Deputy First Minister outlined yesterday. And critically, we're still protecting and ensuring that we are delivering at the earliest possible point that direct support for our farmers and crofters. And we're trying to deliver it early to ensure that there is that maintenance and that cash flow going forward. So I would want to give her an assurance on that regard. But one of the biggest threats that we also face is having no clarity on what our budget settlement is going to be from the UK Government going beyond this coming financial year. And that is where I would hope that all members in this chamber could join with me in asking that we get that clarity so we know what funding is available going forward.
Question 5, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether urban areas will be included in its land reform legislation.
Cabinet Secretary.
Is an ongoing process, and each piece of work we do builds on the legislation and policies that have come before. In our forthcoming bill, we will be bringing forward a set of robust land reform measures whose key aim is to tackle the scale and concentration of land ownership in Scotland. In 2016, we extended the community right to buy and the funding that went with it to urban communities. And our proposals for the forthcoming bill are based on recommendations from the Scottish Land Commission. They will take account of the views of all of those who responded to our consultation, and in line with established process, final decisions on the bill's contents will be made in due course by ministers, and the bill will of course be published on the Scottish Parliament website following its introduction.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. People owning land or building that they are not using can severely impact urban communities, especially if the use of this land or building is not beneficial to the community. In this situation, urban communities need to be able to buy this land and use it for the purpose that will benefit communities. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise exactly what action the Scottish Government are taking to ensure urban communities' rights are protected under the land reform legislation?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises a really important point there. I think, first of all, I would just want to emphasise that currently we have 4 community rights to buy which exist under various pieces of legislation. There's also the community asset transfers through the Community Empowerment Act, which are currently being reviewed. There's also, and we've made commitments previously in relation to considering compulsory sales orders. Now, that is a really complex piece of work, which is still needs to be undertaken. And I know Minister Jo Fitzpatrick is currently undertaking a piece of work on compulsory purchase orders too, which I think will be considering that piece on CSOs. So I think we have the forthcoming land reform bill. As I've said, we will set out the proposals in relation to that. But I think it's also important not to forget the existing rights that are there. We do need to make sure that they're operating as they should do, but there are also these ongoing pieces of work. But again, I'd be happy to follow up with the member and provide him with more information on each of these.
Brief supplementary, Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Given that this, through this new legislation, the Scottish Government is continuing to support both rural and urban areas through the community buyout process, can the Cabinet Secretary outline whether the new Land Reform Bill will go further than before in terms of increased land ownership transparency?
Briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, of course, that is certainly what we hope it will do. And we really want this bill to ensure that it's as ambitious as possible. So I would just want to reiterate that we are committed to bringing forward a bill that is ambitious in that sense, and that I think will be a significant step forward in ensuring that our land is owned and it's used in the public interest and ultimately for the benefit of the people of Scotland.
Question 6, Russell Findlay.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had regarding the sale of low-welfare pets ahead of the Christmas period.
Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. The Scottish Government works throughout the year to highlight the responsibilities of pet owners and those who sell domestic animals. Although we have not had specific discussions on the sale of low-welfare pets in the run-up to this Christmas, we work closely on an ongoing basis with key stakeholders, including the Scottish SPCA, local authorities and other UK administrations, to raise awareness of low-welfare breeders and inform prospective buyers on how to buy a pet safely throughout the year. I would add that we have run comprehensive public campaigns to raise awareness amongst prospective buyers of pups on the realities of these unlicensed puppy trades, and the information and messaging for these campaigns is available online.
Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Organised crime contaminates many legitimate areas of Scotland's economy, one of these being the lucrative trade in puppies and dogs. These poor animals often suffer chronic ill health, with one drug-dealing dog breeder being prime suspect in a terror campaign that forced a Scottish councillor to quit his post and leave his home. The criminals don't care about people. They certainly don't care about animal welfare. So will the Minister discuss this issue with her Justice Secretary colleague about how to tackle these despicable crooks?
Minister.
I thank Russell Finlay for that. He absolutely lays out there that it doesn't matter what the commodity is, that the unscrupulous people will use any kind of commodity, regardless of what it is. In this case, it's live animals. And it's also the lives of the people that take on these animals, who will be left heartbroken when they're too ill to make it past a certain point. And it's an absolutely disgraceful trade. I would point to the message from the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, who've actually done a campaign of their own this Christmas on this, which has actually been very helpful. And anyone can find it online. It's about highlighting the dangers of engaging in buying a puppy from unscrupulous people like Russell Finlay mentions, but also how that can be funding organised crime. I think it's a very effective campaign, and I would urge everyone in the chamber to look it up online and to share it on their social media over Christmas, because it is very powerful.
Question 7, Sarah Boyd.
To ask the Scottish Government, in relation to its cross-government coordination on islands policies, what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding any impact on island communities of its proposed EPC reforms?
Minister.
I thank Sarah Boyett for that question. Ministers and officials across portfolios are aware of the need to recognise the impact of new policies on island communities. The Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings has taken forward a long-standing Scottish Government commitment to reform energy performance certificates based on Climate Change Committee recommendations, and on which we consulted this year. And our current proposals to reform EPCs do not suggest any new duties or obligations on building owners. We are considering the impact on island communities as we go through the analysis of the consultation responses in the new year, as required by the Island Scotland Act.
Sarah Boyer.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer and say that given the rocketing levels of fuel poverty in off-gas areas in particular and the upcoming Heat and Buildings Bill, what specific support in terms of advice and funding will the Scottish Government offer homeowners to increase the energy efficiency of their properties by installing insulation and to lower their carbon emissions, install affordable heat options and upgrade their homes, for example, being able to access grants to install solar panels to help heat or power their homes?
Minister.
Well, I'd refer Sarah Boyack to the raft of initiatives in Home Energy Scotland, such Home Heating Fund in particular, and she'll have seen from the budget yesterday that there was an uplift in the amount of money given in Mr Harvey's portfolio for the things that she has actually outlined in her question there. I would also say that rural fuel poverty is an issue that is affecting Scotland disproportionately, and I would encourage Sarah Boyack, if she hasn't done already, to support me in my calls for the social tariff, which I have been calling on the UK Government ever since I've been appointed.
Question 8, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it engaged with fishing industry stakeholders as part of the annual fisheries negotiations.
Cabinet Secretary.
We work closely and collaboratively with our stakeholders throughout the negotiation period. And when the scientific advice is published, officials meet with stakeholders from the fishing industry and environmental groups to discuss priorities to feed into the negotiating strategy. We have to seek the best outcome for Scotland's environment, fishing interests and coastal communities, which means that we have to balance environmental, economic and social considerations, as well as then looking at the short and long-term impacts on fish stocks and the fishing industry. Throughout live negotiations, there are regular stakeholder meetings with the chief negotiator, providing updates and allowing stakeholders to ask questions. And if you'll allow me, Presiding Officer, I just want to take a brief moment to thank all those stakeholders who've invested so much time and also their expertise in engaging with us and informing the approach to negotiations, and as well as thanking, of course, our negotiators who always work tirelessly and do their best for the fishing industry in Scotland.
Karen Adam.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I agree with her in the stakeholders and how they negotiate their business. I was delighted to read that the SFF had praised the work of the Scottish Government in this area, and among the quota increases reported were for Scottish fishers were North Sea haddock and North Sea whiting. I would say, though, labour shortages are an acute problem in the seafood sector, particularly within the seafood processing. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to continue to represent the views of the North East Fishers to the UK Government to ensure that the opportunities presented by these increased quotas are not undermined by Brexit-related workforce shortages and the Tory visa rules announced this month?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Just to say that the member does, of course, raise a really important point, and I really just want to emphasise that in Scotland, we, of course, don't share the UK Government approach to migration, and we categorically reject their hostile environment rhetoric. Of course, we do continue to support new domestic entrants to the Scottish seafood industry, but we also recognise and value that really vital contribution that migrant workers make to the sector, as well as to the wider Scottish economy and to our coastal and island communities. By ending freedom of movement from the EU and imposing new visa requirements for qualifications and salary thresholds, the UK Government has made it significantly more difficult to access labour and attract people to Scotland. I've repeatedly called for urgent reform of UK immigration rules, and that's included offering to work with the UK Government to identify pragmatic ways to balance border security and enabling that access to labour. And of course, I will continue to do that.
Thank you very much. That concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs, land reform and islands. I'll take a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change. Okay, the next item of business is portfolio questions on NHS recovery, health and social care. Any member wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant questions. As with rural affairs, there is a lot of interest here. I would appreciate brevity in both the questions and indeed the responses from the front bench team. And I call question number one, Martin Whitfield.
Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what steps it is taking to address obesity.
Minister Jenny Minn.
Thank you. Addressing obesity is a public health priority, and we continue to take forward the wide range of preventative actions to improve diet and promote health across the life course, as outlined in our Diet and Healthy Weight Delivery Plan. This includes provision of core funding of £8.25 million to health boards in 23-24 to deliver adult children and young people's weight management services in line with our national standards and the Type 2 Diabetes Prevention Framework.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for that response. Statistics published by Public Health Scotland reveal that 22% of Primary 1 pupils were at risk of overweight or obesity this year. In 2018, the then First Minister made a commitment the Scottish Government would halve child obesity by 2030. Our current P1s were born in that year. So, by they are in S1, will half of the 22% of pupils who are at risk of overweight or obesity be within acceptable standards?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question, and that is certainly the intention of this government, is working towards ensuring we have halved childhood obesity by 2030 from the original original weights. So I'm working very closely with my officials and third sector organisations to work out the best way that we can do that.
A couple of brief supplementaries. First, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. We know that junk food promotions can encourage overconsumption and impulse buying. So can the Minister provide any update regarding work which is underway on plans to restrict in-premise marketing of food and non-alcoholic drinks that are high in fat, sugar or salt in order to help to reduce consumption and related harms?
Minister.
Thank you. The Scottish Government, as I have said, remains absolutely committed to legislation to restrict the promotion of less healthy food and drink. As part of an extensive consultation process, we've just concluded a series of roundtable events with public health and business stakeholders, which will help to further inform the development of our consultation document on the detail of proposed regulations. The consultation document will be published early next year and will provide an opportunity for stakeholders to comment on the detail of proposed regulations with a view to laying regulations subject to the outcome of that consultation.
Briefly, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Apart from the impact on personal wellbeing that obesity brings, it's also a significant drag on our economy. We have economically inactivity in Scotland is high. It will require behavioural change, both diet and access to physical activity, and the Minister will know my passion for the education environment being the battleground we need to fight that. So with that in mind, can I ask the Minister what work she's doing with the Education Cabinet Secretary to deliver solutions to this problem?
Minister.
I thank the member for his question and recognise the passion that he has for exercise as well as healthy eating. The Scottish Government is clear that we work cross-portfolio on these issues, and I engage with both the Cabinet Secretary for Education and the Minister for Young People.
Thank you. Question two, Monica Lennon.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will reconsider its reported plans to downgrade the Wishaw Neonatal Intensive Care Unit.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. The aim of the NHS and this Government is to ensure that everyone gets the best care possible. That is especially true for neonate babies and their families. The restructuring of neonatal intensive care units was based on expert clinical advice that showed that this change was necessary to improve outcomes for the very smallest and sickest babies. The most preterm and sickest babies do best when they are cared for in larger specialist neonatal units. To undo that would be to choose poorer outcomes for these babies, and that is not a choice we would make. The member will agree that parents would very much expect us to act on such evidence in the best interests of their babies. Local neonatal units across Scotland, including in Wishaw, will continue to offer care to babies who need it, including a level of neonatal intensive care.
Monica Lennon.
The Minister's answer will infuriate and worry my constituents in Lanarkshire and is a further blow to the award-winning neonatal workforce. Almost 20,000 people have now signed a petition to stop the Scottish Government's downgrading of this award-winning, vital, life-saving service. We have a flawed proposal and process that has produced a flawed decision, and it is vulnerable babies, their mothers and families that will be failed unless the Minister listens, looks again and does her job properly. So will she extend some festive goodwill to my constituents, to the Wishaw Neonatal Warriors, and finally commit to a full independent review in the new year?
Minister.
I thank the member for her question, but don't recognise some of the picture that she has painted. Tomorrow I am meeting with NHS Lanarkshire Chief Exec to discuss this situation.
Supplementary, Stephanie Callaghan.
It's certainly welcome that local neonatal units, including Wishaw, will continue to provide care to the vast majority of babies who need it. And the decision to move to three national neonatal intensive care units has been made in line with strong evidence and advice. Does the Minister agree, though, that to deliver the best care outcomes for those smallest and sickest babies born in Scotland, it is important that this expert advice is listened to? And does she also agree, though, that it's vital that the voices of local people are listened to and recognised as part of this process? And advise what steps
Minister,
the Scottish
Minister.
Government is taking?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yes, I do agree with Stephanie Callaghan. We must follow the best advice available. We are doing this to give babies born at the extremes of prematurity, and we are talking about babies who are born before 27 weeks of pregnancy, the best chance of survival. Larger specialist neonatal units have the specialist staff and services available on site to give these tiny babies the very best care. I met with families from Lanarkshire in November to hear their concerns, and we will continue to consult with families in affected areas so they have the opportunity to input into the design of service delivery.
Very briefly, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister has said again that the decision to downgrade is based on clinical advice, which is why I asked in a question if the Minister would meet the award-winning clinicians in Wishaw back in October. The Minister agreed to meet, and I subsequently wrote to clarify arrangements, but no commitment now in that letter to meet with those who lead the unit. Why has the Minister gone back on that promise to meet with the clinicians who run that life-saving unit?
Minister.
The member for his question, and as I said earlier, I am meeting with the Chief Exec of NHS Lanarkshire tomorrow, and that I know that's not what you asked, if you let me finish my sentence, and that exactly will be discussed at that meeting. Thank you.
Can I urge members to ask the question and allow ministers to respond? Question number three, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work of its NHS Forth Valley Assurance Board.
Cabinet Secretary.
The latest version of the improvement plan has recently been agreed by both the Health Board and Insurance Assurance Board, and there is a clear expectation from all involved that progress needs to continue to be made across a range of areas, including leadership, culture and governance. The NHS Forth Valley Assurance Board continues to meet regularly, with the most recent board meeting taking place on the 20th of December 2023. The Assurance Board will continue to monitor and scrutinise the Board's agreed improvement plan. Minutes from the NHS Forth Valley Assurance Board meeting are published and can be viewed at the GovScot website. A copy of the improvement plan is available on NHS Forth Valley's website.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that welcome update? But the waiting times at Forth Valley Royal Hospital A&E have been a long-running concern and have highlighted the strain our dedicated NHS staff are under, particularly in winter. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what assurance there is that staff across health boards, including in Forth Valley, are going to be properly supported through this winter period, particularly so that we can get safe staffing levels with proper breaks and hot meals provided to all staff?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, there's a range of areas where the improvement plans that have been taken forward by Forth Valley are starting to indicate some improvements in the way in which the board is performing. We saw that over the course of recent weeks, and also the fire break, which they're presently operating, has been extended for a further 2 weeks in order to help to support and sustain some of the improvements which have been made. Of course, during the course of our winter period, our NHS is under enormous pressure, particularly at the front door around our A&E departments. And of course, we expect boards to ensure that there are appropriate welfare arrangements in place for staff to support them during the course of their clinical duties.
Question 4, Audrey Nicholl.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with the Scottish Medicines Consortium.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. There are quarterly meetings between the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer and Medicine Policy Officials and the Scottish Medicines Consortium. The last one took place in September 2023 and the next one is scheduled for January 2024. In addition, both the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer and the Head of Medicines Policy meet with representatives of the SMC on a regular and routine basis.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank the Minister for her response. A new drug, trastuzumab deruxtecan, has been approved for use in Scotland for a type of breast cancer called HER2-low. The treatment slows the spread of the cancer, improves the patient's chances of survival when compared against chemotherapy, and will come as very welcome news to people living with this disease. There will, of course, be an eagerness for treatment to begin as quickly as possible. So can I ask the Minister what steps the Scottish Government will take in tandem with the Scottish Medicines Consortium and NHS Scotland to ensure hospitals have access to this life-saving drug as soon as possible?
Minister.
I'm delighted to advise that patients in Scotland will be amongst the first in the UK to receive this life-extending medicine to treat HER2-low breast cancer. The Scottish Medicines Consortium published advice recommending trastuzumab deruxtecan for routine use to treat patients with HER2-low breast cancer within NHS Scotland on the 11th of December 2023. As with other new medicines, once the SMC publishes its advice, it is expected that health boards across Scotland will make this a medicine available for routine prescribing within 90 days of the publication of that advice.
With brief supplementaries, first, Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. My declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. The Scottish Medicines Consortium does not consider that drugs such as paracetamol and ibuprofen require significant advice, given they are readily available over the counter and also available on Pharmacy First. However, schools and NHS Fife state they will not give basic medication like paracetamol and ibuprofen unless the GP has prescribed it. Does the Minister think this is an appropriate use of GP time, given the pressure we are under? And will the Minister undertake to work with the Cabinet Secretary for Education to ensure that this is resolved?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question, and yes, I'd be happy to speak to the Cabinet Secretary of Education with regards to this, and also my Chief Pharmaceutical Officer to understand more about the situation that he's raised.
And Jackie Bailey.
People across Scotland are waiting to find out whether life-changing drugs like Orkambi, Semkevi and Kaftrio will be available on the NHS for those suffering from cystic fibrosis, including those under 2 years of age. I know that the Scottish Medicines Consortium is working with NICE, but can the Minister commit to ensuring that whatever the outcome, these life-saving drugs will be available to everybody in Scotland without a postcode lottery at health board level?
Minister.
I thank the member for her question, and along with Jackie Bailey, I recently met with families representing the cystic fibrosis community and was able to reassure them that in Scotland, whilst the National Institute for Health and Care Excellence and the Scottish Medicines Consortium multiple technology appraisal is ongoing, all existing and new patients who are on or started on a treatment for cystic fibrosis will continue to have access to that treatment after they issue their final recommendations, irrespective of outcome.
Question 5, Stephanie Callaghan.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recent Public Health Scotland report, Infant Feeding Statistics Scotland.
Minister Jenny Minto.
I am delighted that the current infant feeding statistics show that breastfeeding rates across Scotland continue to increase, with over two-thirds of all babies being breastfed at birth and more than half continuing to receive breast milk at 10 to 14 days. Rates at 6 to 8 weeks have risen to 47%, the highest rate on record, showing many more babies are being breastfed for longer than ever before. We are committed to protecting, promoting and supporting breastfeeding as the normal nutrition for babies and giving them the best start in life, with over £9 million of additional investment over the past 5 years.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I welcome that further investment, and encouragingly, increases in breastfeeding over the past 10 years have been greatest amongst those groups with historical lower rates, such as young women and those living in the most deprived areas. However, only 34% of babies born in Scotland's most deprived areas were breastfed at their 6 to 8 week review, and that compares to 63% in the least deprived areas. So what further steps is the Minister planning to improve levels of breastfeeding in deprived areas, and will she consider making additions to the baby box?
Minister.
I thank Stephanie Callaghan for that really important question, and I'm pleased to see that the latest infant feeding statistics show a continued narrowing of the breastfeeding inequalities gap. Our additional investment has been both targeted and based on best evidence of what works. Scaling this up is part of planned next steps. Our infant feeding teams are pivotal in this effort, and we will continue to use all means necessary, including Scotland's baby box, to normalise breastfeeding in Scotland. For teenage parents, many of whom are in the lowest SIMD areas, the Family Nurse Partnership has had a crucial role in supporting them to breastfeed.
Supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The disparity in income deciles and breastfeeding rates is a matter of great concern. Will the Minister consider enhancing support for GP surgeries, particularly around aspects like community link workers and connections with charities like Homestart, to further enhance promotion of breastfeeding in the most deprived communities?
Minister.
I thank Paul Sweeney for that question, and I highlighted in my answer the important work of the family nurse practitioners, but I also agree that there is a lot of work, and it is clear that that is being done by third sector organisations, which the Scottish Government is working with.
And very briefly, Bob Doris.
Thank you, President Officer. Minister, do you agree with me that whilst we want to see increased breastfeeding rates, that it's not always easy or appropriate for all women to breastfeed, and we shouldn't stigmatise those who find that they're unable to breastfeed? All mums need to be equally supported.
Minister.
I think Bob Doris raises a very important point, and I don't disagree with him. I think it is important that all new mums are supported, and I hope, as I've previously referenced, the Family Nurse Partnership is able to support mothers and families in all situations.
Question 6, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government when it plans to establish a specialist endometriosis centre within every NHS board in Scotland.
Minister Jenny Minto.
The role of specialist endometriosis centres in Scotland is to provide coordinated, multidisciplinary treatment to individuals with complex systems of endometriosis and to those requiring complex surgery. Scotland operates 3 centres in Aberdeen, Edinburgh and Glasgow. This was recommended as the optimal approach for effective treatment in Scotland by a specialist working group of expert clinicians and representatives from patient groups and Endometriosis UK. There are no plans to establish a specialist centre within every NHS board.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Local charities in the south of Scotland are dedicated to improving endometriosis treatment. One of them, Endo SOS, says this, and I quote, "Having local centres saves money for patients and the NHS. Travel times are reduced, missed appointments are lower, and referrals to specialist care is faster." They added, "We need more locations to support the rural population and to reduce diagnostic and general waiting times. So, will the Cabinet Secretary find some time to meet with me and local campaigners to discuss the need for a specialist endometriosis centre in the Borders?
Minister.
Thank Rachel Hamilton for that question, and if she's happy to have the meeting with the Minister, then I would be very happy to meet with her and her constituents.
Supplementary, Emma Harper.
We know that how substantial an impact endometriosis can have in women's lives. It's clear that we need to continue to press forward with research into this condition to ensure that the most effective treatment options and support can be provided. Can the Minister provide any further information regarding work which the Scottish Government is undertaking to support research into endometriosis-associated pain?
Minister.
I thank Emma Harper for that question. We are jointly funding a £250,000 endometriosis research project with the charity Wellbeing of Women. The research project, which will primarily be run by researchers at the University of Edinburgh, will look at the drug dichloroacetate, I think, in the management of endometriosis-associated pain, and it's a fantastic project. I was privileged enough to visit them in the summer. Additionally, in January 2023, our Chief Scientist Office announced funding for the EndoCan project led by researchers at the University of Edinburgh through a large-scale UK-wide trial. The research will investigate whether a cannabinoid can reduce endometriosis-associated pain. Funding of just under £300,000 has been committed to this 30-month project.
And briefly, Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As well as expanding the number of specialist endometriosis centres, it's also critical that the impacts of endometriosis are recognised in the workplace. I was pleased to learn that East Ayrshire Council have become the first local authority in Scotland to officially recognise the impact endometriosis has on female employees, taking on the endometriosis friendly employer scheme. Can I ask the Minister what engagement she's had with the scheme and if she would take some necessary steps to encourage all councils to engage with this important scheme?
Minister.
I thank Carol Mochan for her question, and yes, I think these schemes are so important. I recently launched one within NHS, across NHS Scotland staff, with regard to menopause and various other areas, and I think it's incredibly important that workplaces absolutely appreciate the impact that various conditions have on their workforce and get the right policies in place to ensure that workers are able to be there and do the best in their jobs.
Question 7, Pauline McNeill.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it has reviewed GP services model, including in relation to whether patients are getting appointments when they need them.
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, I'm clear that patients should always have access to general medical services and that all local NHS boards should ensure that GP services continue to be provided to all patients. Patients should always be able to see GPs when they need to. 5 years on from the joint agreement between the Scottish Government and the British Medical Association on the 2018 GP contract, our health and social care partnerships have made significant progress in recruiting multidisciplinary teams to support general practices. We currently have over 4,500 staff working in these teams, providing services including physiotherapy, pharmacy and phlebotomy.
Pauline McNeill.
There are a rapidly increasing number of patients seeking GP appointments, but combined with cuts to primary care development fund, this demand is placing immense pressure on GP services and leaving many patients facing long delays or simply unable to get an appointment when they need one. GPs are often working double, if not triple, the recommended limit of 25 consultations a day, and Audit Scotland have said that the Government are unlikely to deliver their promise of 800 new GPs by 2027. Could I ask the Cabinet Secretary to address a specific point about the design of the appointment system? And that is that some patients report that they use one system and they can get an appointment, and other patients report that the GP uses a completely different system and they have to wait longer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that really every patient across Scotland should expect the same design of service
Cabinet
to get
Secretary,
the same
Cabinet
efficient
Secretary.
Service?
Also, dealing with a very specific issue that the Member raises in terms of appointment system is that it's down to individual GP practices because the vast majority of them are independent contractors. And it's their responsibility to design a system that best meets the needs of the contract in order to deliver appointments to patients. The member may be aware that in October we published the outcomes from what was the General Practice Access Principles work that was taken forward to look at helping to try and get greater consistency, and it made a set of principles that has asked GP practices to apply. But because of the independent contractor model, it is down to individual practices to decide on what the model is that they use locally.
Brief supplementary, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Despite the heroic efforts of GPs and their teams, too many of our constituents are struggling to see their doctors. Earlier this year, a constituent in the Scottish Borders received a positive bowel cancer test with a letter saying a blood test was urgent. The local GP practice said that an appointment would take at least 10 days. With cases like these right across South Scotland, isn't it time that the Scottish Government properly invested in GP services and matched the Scottish Conservatives' commitment to invest 11% of the NHS budget into primary care?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, we are investing in primary care services. Now, I recognise the concern that the member has raised, but there is a variation in how some GP practices operate. So there are practices in terms of how they operate. It depends on how they approach certain issues and how some patient services are actually being provided. And I've witnessed that firsthand from my own personal experience and also from my experience as Health Secretary. So it is important that we do make sure that people receive good quality services from GPs, which is why we're increasing recruitment of GPs, and also the number of speciality places which we're offering for training as GPs has been increased this year and will increase next year again, in order to make sure that we continue to invest in primary care.
And very briefly, Willie Rennie.
I'm afraid to tell the Cabinet Secretary that the recruitment of those additional staff that he's talked about, pharmacists, physiotherapists, mental health staff, phlebotomists, is not progressing well in my constituency in North East Fife. I met GP practices last week and they told me about recruitment difficulties with NHS Fife. Would the Cabinet Secretary consider transferring responsibility for recruitment of those additional staff over to the GP practices so they can make some progress?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet
Secretary. Officer, the challenge with what Mr Rennie has actually suggested is that it introduces further variation because different GP practices could take a different approach which might not involve the provision of the wider multidisciplinary team that we're trying to achieve. However, I have said to the BMA that I'm open to looking at alternative models from the existing model which we have operating, but the outcomes for patients must continue to be improved as a result of expanding a multidisciplinary team. And I'm more than happy to continue to engage with the BMA on this issue, but it is essential we make sure that there is a consistency of approach on how the multidisciplinary teams are being provided across the country.
Thank you, and with apologies to those I wasn't able to call, that concludes portfolio questions on NHS recovery, health and social care. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.